Pam, I have friends in Oakville. The streets are paved with gold. Every second street is Mansion Alley. These are not stupid people. They're very accomplished. Their council has voted unanimously to investigate fluoride in their water. What's up, Pam?
Yes, the city council has unanimously agreed to listen to the citizens in Oakville who are concerned about the addition of this artificial fluoride in the water.
Old Dan and I with throats burned dry and souls that cry for water. Cool, clear water.
So one of the issues we have spoken about on the radio is the Safe Drinking Water Act. And right in the Safe Drinking Water Act, it says that if you are knowingly adding something toxic to the water, it is illegal.
Cool, clear water.
Yeah, we could get sentimental about just having cool, clear, clean water. Is that too much to ask? Folks, my wife and I are going to visit friends in Oakville. If you've ever been to Oakville, it's not a big exaggeration to say the streets are paved with gold. Have you seen some of the mansions along the lake in Oakville? It's a lovely, lovely city. A lot of very accomplished people live there. And they're doing something very interesting now on the fluoride issue. Joining me this morning, as she always does on Thursday morning, a nutritional consultant and generally a pain in the butt on a lot of health issues because she so insists on educating us about the real truth on so many of these issues is Pam Colleen. Good morning, Pam.
Good morning, Andy.
What are they doing in Oakville?
Well, they've hired a lawyer. And now they have asked the city councilors to meet with them so that the lawyer can do a presentation on June 26th. And they've all unanimously agreed to listen to what the lawyer has to say.
Why a lawyer? And this is on the issue of fluoride.
I mean, this is really a serious subject. I know a lot of people are complacent on this issue simply because it's not something you can see or taste necessarily. You know, fluoride that is added to the water is almost invisible to the average consumer. So we get very complacent on this issue. But this is a very serious issue because it involves ethics and it involves legal issues as well. And so we can't just be out medicating people without knowing their medical history, for example. And that's just another aspect of this story that we'll probably get into this morning.
Calgary, Waterloo, some neighbors in southwestern Ontario, they've all ditched fluoride from the water. But you're sensing that Oakville could be a whole new chapter in this battle.
Right. I have this feeling that Oakville is going to be ground zero for really getting to the nitty-gritty of the issues around fluoride. I think that they're going to be successful in this venture.
We have a couple of guests, and we're going to introduce them in just a moment. Okay, on the issue of fluoride, this appears to be a major new chapter. We have a couple of very special guests. Pam, would you introduce them?
Right. This morning we have Dr. Paul Connett joining us. He was in Oakville last night. He gave a speech on fluoride. And also we have Lisa Ciancino on the line, and she's a concerned citizen of Oakville and has been working very, very hard on this issue for quite a few years. So good morning to both of you, Lisa and Paul.
Well, first of all, Paul, did you not get the memo, Paul, about what you're supposed to do when you're retired?
Thank you, Andy.
Good morning.
I think the memo said, please now work twice as hard as you did when you were being paid.
Wow. And Paul Connett is very well known in London. He's a crusader. He's a guy who, in his retirement years, has become one of the foremost crusaders to get fluoride out of water. So, Pam, who is Lisa?
Lisa Ciancino. Good morning, Lisa.
Good morning, Lisa.
Yeah. Good morning. Thank you so much for having me on.
My wife and I, as I said, we're going to Oakville this weekend. Oakville
actually, if I can just interject, and I'm so sorry, because Paul is staying in Oakville, it isn't the Halton region that's fighting the fluoride at the moment. It is Peel region, so we're going to just backtrack a little bit. It's Peel region. We have 1,300,000 people, so we are the Mississauga area, the Brampton, and the Caledon area. So three communities.
We're talking Hurricane Hazel, who has more years as mayor than anybody on the planet, as far as I know.
That's right. So we're talking Peel region at this point.
Okay.
So that's where I'm from. Yes.
Awesome.
So I think the confusion is because Paul is staying in Oakville.
Okay.
And we had the event here in Mississauga last night. So I apologize if there is any confusion there. But So anyway, it is Peel Region.
Okay, so the issue is fluoride. How do you plug into it, Lisa?
Well, actually, I have been researching this issue for quite some time. And I, you know, as you go through this, and as Pam said, it's one of those issues that, you know, you just, it's so it's controversial. But not only that, I felt that, is this really true? Is this really happening? And so for me, that was, you know, my journey. I could not believe it was actually happening. And I just kept researching, and I was able to connect with Dr. Paul Conant and many, many people around the world. And so we have been working hard trying to educate our city councilors. And unfortunately, it is true. Everything that we know about fluoridation, the adverse effects on human health and the environment are just unbelievable. I wish this would go away, but unfortunately, this is the reality. So the truth is coming out. And having Paul last night, it was our very, very first public awareness campaign to end fluoridation. So we're just starting our journey, and you know, we have educated the counselors, and that was our goal, and we did it in a very respectful way. And then you get to a point where, you know, when you exhaust all your avenues, you've got to take the next step. So we were really blessed to have some anonymous funding come through, and so we were able to get a lawyer, and that's where we are right now.
Okay, so what are the issues then that you're bringing up with regards to the lawyer? I know Nader Hassan is your lawyer, and he's going to be meeting with the city council on June 26th. He's going to be doing a complete presentation. What are some of the issues that you can discuss on the radio?
Well, actually, I would rather hold off simply because the city doesn't have any information at the moment. So it's just something that, you know, he's looked at everything. And Paul did have a chance to look over the brief.
Yeah.
And maybe you want to ask Paul, like, he's very, very impressed.
Well, I'm getting to that. We're going to, you know, everybody knows if you're a Toronto Blue Jays fan, if you've got a guy at the bat, you want it to be Jose Bautista. if it's if the ball game is about fluoride, the guy you want at the plate is Dr. Paul Conant. How did it go last night, Doctor?
Well, I think it went very well, but overriding this is I think you'd have to be wildly optimistic at this time to think that fluoridation will go beyond 2 years from now. When they hear from the lawyer, when he articulates that a case against fluoridation in Canada is going to win, there's two things here. One is most councils, if they heard that brief, are going to say, we better get out of this as fast as we can because we are liable for so much in damages. The quicker that we stop this practice, the better. That would include London, Ontario. But the second thing is, if this does go to court and they have their witnesses cross-examined under oath, if these medical officers of health or any other spokesman from Health Canada was to go into court and was asked to produce the evidence which demonstrates the fluoridation is safe and effective, they cannot do it. They will be demolished. And all those councillors who are putting their faith on these statements from the local medical officer of health, who are trooped out like little dummies, like little puppets, just mouthing the policy statements of Health Canada, they will realize that they have been grossly misled. This is a huge betrayal of the public's trust and a huge betrayal of the decision makers. And as Lisa has pointed out, don't blame the decision makers. They pay these people's salary. They pay these medical officers what, over $200,000 a year to give them advice on these issues. And instead of getting objective science from these people, they are getting propaganda. They're getting the political statements from Health Canada. Now, we can say that till we're blue in the face, Andy, and you've been doing a fantastic job on the air for a couple of years at least, I know. But the rubber is going to hit the road when these spokesmen are shown to have feet of clay, when they are cross-examined under oath. So two things then. This when this lawyer on June the 26th presents the brief that I've already read, I think the council, the regional council, is going to back out of fluoridation as quickly as possible. They might take this position. They might say, we're going to stop fluoridation, until these questions are answered by Health Canada, by the medical officers of health. You know, it will stop. It's up to you to bring the answers to fundamental questions like, has the chemical used in fluoridation ever been subjected to toxicological testing? The answer is no, but they can't say that. They won't say that.
But this has been an issue, Paul. This has been an issue. We've asked our health unit, we've asked our city councillors, we've asked our mayor for the safety studies. This is a question that we have put out for many, many years now, and so far they're coming up empty-handed. We had a city councillor, Joni Beckler, who did her own due diligence, and she made huge amounts of phone calls and did a ton of research to find out if there were any toxicological studies. She came up empty-handed. I mean, nothing was done after that point.
Yeah. There's none. And as I say, the smart thing to do would be to back out and leave it up to the other side to produce the kind of answers that they refuse to produce in public. They will not answer these questions. Lisa's had a huge runaround trying to get answers from the regional body, the Health Canada, to these fundamental, basic questions. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is if they stonewall and they say, oh, take us to court, we don't care, take us to court, then they're going to find that their experts, the people that they relied on, who've bamboozled the public for 60 years in this country, they're going to find that they don't have a leg to stand on. They simply do not have the science to back up their overconfident claims that fluoridation is safe and effective. We know that already, because if they had the science, Andy, Pam, they would have debated me long ago. They would have put me on that platform and fried me with their superior knowledge, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But they've steadfastly refused to debate myself and other key people like Hardy Lineback and James Beck and so on. But they won't be able to run once we get them into court.
Lisa, let me bounce this question over to you. Do you get the sense that the people in Peel Region will pay, especially the councillors, will pay more attention to lawyers than they will to arguments about fluoride diminishing the IQ of our children and grandchildren?
Yes, that's a very good question. I think one of the things that most communities that are pursuing this to get rid of fluoride in their drinking water, what I find is they want to hear from the experts. And, you know, it's as if, you know, we can bring the information forward. We can put together wonderful presentations. I actually presented information from Dr. Hardy Lineback, who lives in my community. And he was just so instrumental helping us put together the information. But they want to see the experts. They want to hear from them. And I know that, you know, Dr. Lineback was asked, you know, are you going to be presenting? And he basically cannot do that. You know, he still has his practice here in Mississauga in Ward 2. And, you know, it's one of those things. So I really believe that having the lawyer, and this is all the information, you know, that he will be sharing. And we also wanted, to just backtrack, we wanted to have a roundtable discussion with the Minister of Health, the provincial leaders, and the federal. And we tried that with the Ontario Dental Association president, Dr. Cooney. We invited everyone. And unfortunately, they refused to come. They said, thank you for your kind invitation. And so that was the first meeting on September 28th, I believe it was. Then I pursued with our regional chair. I pleaded and I said, please, can we have another meeting? Because Mayor McCallion couldn't make the one on the 28th. We were actually still going to have it, our experts, because we feel we need to bring the experts to the councillors so that they can hear from them. And when Mayor McCallion couldn't come, I spoke to her that morning when I heard that she wasn't able to make it. Mayor McCallion, we need you there. You know, this is about common sense, and we knew that she would understand the whole picture. And so then we pursued a second round table, and unfortunately, again, the same thing happened. So you can only do so much. And then the region was trying to be supportive of us. So they said, would you be prepared, you know, in their resolution, they would propose to send our questions from the Concerned Residents Appeal to the Health Canada for answers.
And Andy, you've been doing this for a long time with Pam Colleen. You guys are awesome. We wish we had somebody like you here in Peel. I've listened to all of your shows, and I think that you're wonderful because you're able to share this information with your community, your listeners.
Lisa.
And yes.
I would like to take a bow, but let me ask you for a favor. Can you please not let Dr. Paul Connett know this, okay? This is between you and I, okay? We have often, in our discussions with him, talked about the fact that our health minister lives right here in London. She is the health minister, and she's a deputy premier, absolutely deaf on screams of outrage over about 27 different scandals in her ministry. But as health minister, she was promoted to deputy premier. And I'm embarrassed to say, Lisa, that in the recent elections last week, she was in a sea of blue, conservative blue, all across Southwest Ontario. She was reelected. Please don't share that with Dr. Paul Connett, or he'll despair so much he'll hang up. We're going to take a short break. When we come back, lawyers now involved in the fight against fluoride in Peel Region. What does it mean? Is this a new beachhead? We'll be back with that in just a moment, right here on London Today on News Talk 1290 CJBK.
I think you'd have to be wildly optimistic at this time to think that fluoridation will go beyond 2 years from now. When they hear from the lawyer, when he articulates that a case against fluoridation in Canada is going to win, there's two things here. One is, most councils, if they heard that brief, are going to say, we better get out of this as fast as we can because we are liable for so much in damages. The quicker that we stop this practice, the better. That would include London, Ontario.
All day I face the barren waste without the taste of water, cool water.
Okay, if you have just joined us, we're talking about fluoride and water and a new ray of hope that some of our neighbors may be able to do what we have not been able to do in London, and that is get our big 12, size 12 shoes and give the boot to fluoride in our drinking water. Okay, back to Pam Colleen. Now, Pam, we heard the name Dr. Hardy Limebeck, and we have heard that name over the years in this debate. Remind our audience again of who Dr. Hardy Limebeck is.
Dr. Hardy Limebeck is a professor of preventative dentistry at the University of Toronto, and he set out initially to prove the efficacy of artificial water fluoridation, and unfortunately during his research he found out that the opposite was true, that this is a practice that needs to be stopped, that there are health consequences attached to it, and so he basically completely did an about face on his views around fluoridation.
Because one of the questions we get, well, name me a dentist who wants fluoride out of the water.
Well, there's a lot of dentists that are on board. What dentists are using in the office, what people are putting on their teeth, that is a pharmaceutical grade form of fluoride. What is being put in our water supply is a waste product. This is a product that comes from the smokestacks of the fertilizer industry. It's scraped from the smokestacks. And the EPA in the United States deemed this product to be too unsafe for the air, too unsafe for lakes, waterways in general, and too unsafe for the land. And so when the industry decided to sell it as a value-added product to municipalities, suddenly, miraculously, this product became safe. And it's just not a safe product.
I want to go back to the Peel region now and this battle to get fluoride out of the water. Lisa, let me ask you, how we've got so many issues in the news. My own sister says, Andy, I can't listen to your show because I get too depressed about all the crises in the world. We all know what's happening in Iraq right now. We know what's happening in Syria. We know what's happening with our debt. We've just reelected a Liberal government. Ontario is sliding into Lake Erie. Now we've got the mayor resigning as of about 30 minutes ago. All this, how do you ever get an issue like fluoride to get the attention of enough folks so that you can launch a battle to get it out of the water, Lisa?
Well, that's a million-dollar question, isn't it? what we did was, as I mentioned, it's been everything behind the scenes up to this point. And reason for that was, you know, if I was a young mother today raising my children, they're now adults, but if I was a young mother and somebody had told me about the fluoridation issue, that it's a toxic waste byproduct that's being put into the water supply, that it never has been tested. So there are no toxicological studies done. In 68 years, this practice has been going on. I would be outraged. And, the fact that, you've got mothers, who some choose to breastfeed their children and some are mixing the baby formula with their tap water. So the percentage of fluoride that the mothers who are giving it to their children with tap water is like upwards of 200 times the amount. And so these types of things would just make me just feel like, how can a municipality, a group of leaders, and there's 25 municipal councillors that represent the Region of Peel. I don't know what I would do if I was a young mother today. So I think the thing is that we didn't want to scare people. We don't want to alarm them. But the reality is, and as I mentioned, and I will praise you once again, you are sounding the alarm bells. You're doing it, and they're not listening.
Now, Lisa, you've had some dealings with some other influential groups out there, the Council of Canadians, the Sierra Club, clubs like that as well, have you?
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you for mentioning that. Well, the thing is so we will bring everything to the table. So the lawyer is going to be presenting, we'll pull, and Dr. Connett and I were discussing that yesterday. I mentioned that I'd like to pull that together and present that and have it as a package. Because I've, as you mentioned, Pam, we've got the Council of Canadians. They've given us a resolution. We've got the ULAC, and the ULAC is they've got a wonderful resolution. They're the oldest Hispanic civil rights organization in the U.S., and so they have a resolution against Asian. So they're a huge, huge organization. We have the, who else do we have? We've got the Sierra Club. We've got CAPE.
They're environmental physicians, yes.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Thank you. So we've got their resolution. So, we'll be bringing all of that to the table. Andy, your question is, how do you bring this information? I was one of the many, many people who stopped the power plant here in Peel. We work very, very hard. And, so it's one of those things, like you said, now it's another issue. But this, there's no possible way you can compare the two because we all need water. We need it. It's our life source. It's a fundamental human right. We know that cities all over work very hard with their treatment plants to have clean water. And they put in the chlorine and whatever chemicals they need. But when they're putting in this fluoridated chemical additive, which is not pharmaceutical grade, which is coming, not only is it a toxic waste byproduct with no safety studies, it's industrial use product. And as Pam said, how can they possibly put it into your water after? Miraculously, it changes into this product to protect your teeth.
Absolutely. Let me bounce this question over to Dr. Paul Connett. Dr. Connett, my goodness, you are on the road so much in your crusade against fluoride. Give us some rays of hope outside of southwestern Ontario. Where are the bright lights that we should take inspiration from in the battle to get fluoride out of our drinking water?
I will certainly do that, Andy. But first of all, you posed a question to Lisa about how you've got all these issues, Iraq, Syria, Ukraine, you name it. Why should fluoride be considered amongst all those giant issues? And the answer is you can't go to the waterworks and turn off Syria. You can't go to the waterworks and turn off the Ukraine problem. You can't turn off Iraq. But with this issue, it's something that we're doing to ourselves. We can end it tomorrow simply by turning off a tap. That is why this issue should be uppermost in people's minds. It's an issue that can be solved. It can be ended if we had common sense and integrity coming into the fore from our municipalities and so on. One other thing I should stress is that not only is the lawyer bringing forward this brilliant, articulate legal case, but he's also bringing with him one of the best experts, in my view, on fluoride's toxicity, and that's Dr. Kathleen Thiessen, who is a member of the National Research Council team that reviewed fluoride's toxicity in 2006. She is brilliant. Now, we've got two kinds of experts out there, Andy. You've got the experts like me that don't worry, go to the public. I'm a street fighter. I fire from the hip. I give people what I believe. I give the science to support it, but I'm outspoken. And when it comes to court, that will probably hurt me. They will say, you're a protagonist. You're one-sided, blah, 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 blah. But they can't do that with Kathleen Thiessen. She's calm, cool, collected, and she gets all her ducks in a row. She documents everything scientifically. And she doesn't go out in much in public and muddy her pitch, if you like. So there's two things that are going to happen on June the 26th. The councillors, the regional councillors, are going to see that we have a very powerful legal case, and it's backed up with a brief from a scientist, a top-notch scientist, that can prove chapter and verse everything that we've been talking about.
Okay, so Lisa, would you just take the baton from Paul and just roll out the best-case scenario for this latest push in Peel Region to get fluoride out of the water with the help of a lawyer? What's the best-case scenario? Can you describe that in 90 seconds?
Okay, best-case scenario. I would say that once he makes his presentation, we are actually, a lot of people are going to be attending this to support our lawyer, and then it obviously will fall in the hands of our legal team at the region. And so they will be looking at this, and hopefully our goal is to say, you know, turn it off until you can prove that it is safe for human consumption, and then they can deal with all the legal stuff that there's just so much. So that would be our ultimate goal, is to right now say we have to protect the health and wellness of the citizens of Peel Region, and so we're asking them to please end fluoridation. And that's the goal.
We have to take one more short break. When we come back, I'll ask you, if they had gotten the fluoride out of the water in Peel Region, does that mean that Hazel McCallion could have been the mayor until she was 122? We'll be back with more in just a moment right here on London Today on News Talk 1290 CJBK. Oh, my goodness. Trying to convince people to get fluoride out of the water. I remember some of the big campaigns we've had over the years, Pam, seatbelts. I mean, how many years did it take to convince people it wasn't a good idea to be going down a highway at 80 miles an hour with mom with a little baby sitting on her lap? I think of smoking.
Smoking, absolutely.
At my sister's wedding, they handed out packages of cigarettes.
Leaded gasoline.
Now, distracted driving. You still see people every day. So I guess, Dr. Paul Connett, patience is the word, but are there rays of hope? I asked you the question earlier, and I wonder if you can just quickly address it. Lights of hope around the world where people are getting the message that fluoride, we need to get it out of the drinking water.
Yes, Andy, rays of hope. Since 2010, 138 communities around the world, many of them in Canada, have rejected fluoridation. Here in Canada, thanks to the efforts of COFCOF, the Citizens Opposed to Fluoridation, and many citizens groups, many, many communities have stopped fluoridation. The percentage of the Canadian public now drinking fluoridated water is down to 32%. This month in Israel, the mandatory fluoridation of all Israeli cities has been lifted. It's no longer mandatory. This is sending shockwaves around the world, including Ireland, which has mandatory fluoridation. We're getting town after town now in Ireland saying to the government, we do not want fluoridation. If it was left to them, they would vote fluoridation out. So I think the pressure is on Ireland to lift mandatory fluoridation. I believe that Canada is the key, that when Canada stops fluoridation, which I think will happen within 2 years, largely based upon this legal initiative, it will send shockwaves into, first of all, New Zealand, where there's a huge amount of activity, then into Australia, and then eventually into the United States.
You just dropped a little bit of a bombshell. Can I ask you to repeat that? Your prediction about how long it will be, how short a time it'll be before Canada eliminates fluoride from our drinking water?
I think you'd be wildly optimistic if at this point you said there would be fluoridation in Canada 2 years from now. I think it will take 2 years, the time it takes to get into court, the time it takes to get those medical officers of health and Health Canada to testify under oath. When they go under oath, it will be clear to everybody, to every decision maker in Canada, that the experts they've been relying on do not have the science on their side, and it's time to stop this foolish practice, which is totally unnecessary.
Now, you've been to Canada several times to attend and give presentations and so on, but to date, you have not had a formal debate on the subject here in Canada. You have actually offered to have a debate with some of our health experts, and to date, they have always declined your offer to debate them.
And Lisa has offered for me to come back in August, September, whenever, and debate any of the promoters of fluoridation in the Peel region. We don't anticipate they will take us up, but that would be the ideal. You know, last night we had a school teacher. He said to me, you know, I would like to see an issue like this debated in public. And would you be willing to debate? I said, I've been trying to get debates with these people for 18 years. And around the world, I've only had about six. They just, and that's the clearest indication that they don't have a case. I mean, they've got people in these bureaucracies working full time on this. They could deploy a staff of five or six people to get to grips with everything I've said in public, everything I've written on paper, my book, the whole book, and they could put me on a public platform, absolutely crucify me if they had the science on their side. They could have the TV cameras rolling, and they would have got rid of me.
Okay, so Dr. Connett, let me jump in. Yes. I can't imagine having you on for an hour and not asking you at some point. Okay, for those who may not have heard the arguments in favor of getting fluoride out of, you take the next 2 minutes and just list, without getting into a lot of details, the key reasons why we need to get fluoride out of our drinking water in London, Ontario.
Number one, you should never use the public water supply to deliver medication. Because once you put a medicine in the water, you can't control the dose. You can't control who gets it. It goes to everybody, indiscriminate. And thirdly, it violates the individual's right to informed consent to medication. The key fact as far as whether fluoride is needed is the level in mother's milk. It's extremely low, which means that a bottle-fed baby in London, Ontario, or anywhere else in a fluoridated community is getting about 200 times more fluoride than nature intended for the newborn baby. This is reckless. We have, in the United States, 40% of our children have clearly overexposed to fluoride because they have a condition called dental fluorosis. But that's what you can see. What about what you can't see? When fluoride is damaging the growing teeth cells in a baby's body, what's it doing to the baby's brain? What's it doing to its bones? What's it doing to its thyroid gland? And now the evidence is coming in. We have 37 studies which show an association between lowered IQ and exposure to fairly modest levels of fluoride. The lowest level, which lowers IQ in all these studies, is 1.23 parts per million. That leaves no margin of safety to protect all the children in Ontario, all the children in Canada from lowered IQ. Simply, and I've done calculations which indicate that a child, to protect all our children, you wouldn't want any child drinking more than 2 teaspoons of fluoridated water to make sure that you're protecting all our kids from lowered IQ. And then to top all this up, they cannot demonstrate a grade A study which shows that swallowing fluoride actually reduces tooth decay, and even they have admitted that the predominant mode of action of fluoride, as far as the benefit is concerned, is topical. It works on the outside of the tooth, not from inside the body. And when they admitted this in 1999, that should have been the end of fluoridation, because if fluoride works topically, it's readily available to every man, woman, and child in this country in the form of fluoridated toothpaste. You can brush it on your teeth and spit it out. This way you avoid exposing every tissue in the body to unknown toxic substance, and you don't have to force it on people that don't want it.
Dr. Connett, let me ask you this. Just a minutes ago, just less than an hour ago, our mayor, Joe Fontana, was forced to resign after being convicted of a number of criminal charges relating to the theft, literally, of $1,700. What should be the retribution, the punishment for all those politicians out there and health ministry officials who have ignored the fluoride issue, who haven't bothered to read your book, who continue to pour fluoride into our water? I'm sure you've taken a moment or two along the way to say, what would be the poetic justice that they should meet once we finally do get fluoride out of the water for having put us through this over all these decades?
Well, I don't want to point the fingers looking backwards. Let's point the finger forwards. Let's invite all these people to the celebration party. Let's forget the past and focus on the future. Let's focus on what we should be doing to protect children's teeth. And the good news is in Scotland, where they don't have water fluoridation, they have a highly cost-effective program which has dramatically slashed tooth decay in low-income families, low-income children, simply by having teaching how to brush your teeth in nursery schools, giving them a better diet, sharing this information with parents, and providing interventions, annual checkups, and so on. This is dramatically reduced tooth decay in low-income children in Scotland. That's the way forward. Let's go forward together. Let's be positive. Let's work together. As again, I don't hold it so much against the municipal officials. They have simply taken at face value the information that their medical officers of health and Health Canada have given them, and that's the massive betrayal of the trust. They've been betrayed. They have been betrayed. We're liberating them from that betrayal. And I think if there's anything in the future for retribution, it should be questioning whether Health Canada has any future in Canada. They have so disgraced themselves with promoting this practice and some other things that maybe it's time to have a new organization in which the key issue is integrity. That's what we should expect from any civil servant. If we're going to pay their salaries, we want the truth from them. We don't want propaganda. We don't want spin. We don't want lies. We want the truth. We can live with the truth, but we can't live with public servants who miss.
Well, on that note, I mean, they're going to be disgraced today when Time magazine hits the newsstands, of course, because Andy and I last week, we interviewed Nina Tykols in her book, The Big Fat Surprise, and Time magazine, the front cover, is a swirl of butter saying the science has been wrong about demonizing animal fat for the last four decades.
Yeah.
So, and Health Canada, what have they been doing? They've been promoting a dietary lie. They have been promoting a high carbohydrate, low fat diet, which doesn't have the science to prove that it's healthy. And now, today, Time magazine front cover.
Yep.
They're going to have to eat crow on this issue as well.
Let's before time runs out on us here, Lisa. You've been battling a way to get fluoride out of the water in Peel region. Again, for those who have just joined us in the last few minutes, just lay out very quickly, if you would, the fact that you've now recruited a lawyer and how you see this rolling out in the coming days and weeks.
Okay. I would like to add, if I could, Andy, that we've been very, very fortunate having counselor at the city who has been championing this cause with us. So having him on board has made this much, much easier. So I wanted to make sure I could get that in. And his name is John Sprovieri, Councillor Sprovieri. Anyway, so now, you know, basically, as you mentioned, you know, now with this public meeting that we had last night, so it's a campaign to let people know this is where we're at. We need them to know it's hydrofluorosilicic acid that's being put in our drinking water. It's a toxic byproduct. No safety studies ever been done. And if I could just add, in Ormond Beach, Florida, with a counselor there, he sent to 47 manufacturers for North America, and including some Canadian manufacturers who produce this chemical, and he asked toxicology studies on the safety and the effectiveness of the products, and not one back. And he's a commissioner. So there's a lot of great people working hard. But in Peel Reef, as I mentioned to you, our goal is to urge the members of council to listen to the lawyer's opinion and then to take action and stop putting in the hydrofluorosilicic acid into our drinking water supply, because concerned residents want the toxicology studies that prove they have studied these chemicals that are put in our water for the consumption of every single citizen in the region of Peel.
Lisa, we're out of time.
Prove that it's safe. That's all we're asking.
We're out of time. Dr. Conant, again, that very hopeful prediction about how long it will be till Canada ditches fluoride?
Yep. So I think anybody will be wildly optimistic at this point if they believe that fluoridation was still staggering on 2 years from now.
That's right.
So you're saying we're going to get the fluoride out of the water within 2 years?
Absolutely.
Wow.
As soon as it goes to court, it will be clear that those experts, the medical officers of health, etc.